Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update from Rao's IAS. So now we are also officially available on Telegram. To get the latest updates from Rao's IAS, join the official Telegram channel of Rao's IAS, the link for which has been shared in the description. Hello and welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we'll be taking up the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 27th March 2021. Now the articles to be discussed are reflected on your screen and the timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. So now let's begin. Now this article appearing on the page number 8 of the Hindu newspaper has been titled as Dormant Parliament Fading Business. Now in this article that has been written by M.K. Madhavan, who is the president of PRS Legislative Research. In this article talks about the gradual deterioration in the parliament's functioning, because of which it has almost virtually stopped to fulfill its constitutional mandate. Now, since this article talks about the functioning of the parliament, hence it falls under the mandate of GS Paper 2, subsection Polity, that talks about the parliament and the functioning of the state legislature. Now, in this article, the author is basically talking about the recently concluded budget session, wherein 13 high-impact bills were introduced and were not even discussed or referred to the Parliament Committee. Now, these important bills included the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi Bill, which aims to shift the governance of Delhi from the hands of legislature and the elected government to the hands of the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. Further, it introduced the Mines and Mineral Amendment Bill 2021 that aimed to remove restrictions from the end use of mines, as well as introduce conditions for easing the captive mining of coal. Thirdly, it involved a critical bill with respect to National Bank for financing and infrastructure development. Herein, the government aimed to introduce a new infrastructure finance institution and permit private sector in the area of infrastructure development. And lastly, it included the insurance bill that introduced the FDI from 49% to 74%. And thus, all these critical bills and high impact bills were introduced without any discussion in the parliament or reference to parliament standing committee. And as a result of which, the author is raising concerns with respect to the functioning of the parliament. Now, as we move ahead in this discussion, we'll first discuss basics about functioning of Indian parliament. Next, we'll move towards the issues that are affecting the parliament's functioning. And at last, we'll discuss the measures that we need to undertake in order to get back the parliament in order, so as to ensure it fulfills its constitutional mandate to perfection. So now let's begin this discussion. Now, as we all know, India has adopted the parliamentary form of democracy, wherein the parliament is the embodiment of people's will. That is, it is through the parliament that the citizens of India reflect their will. Now, this is done through a process wherein the citizen elect their representative that forms member of this parliament. Now, this parliament constitutes the president, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. And thus, it is through this indirect process that the citizens of the country represent their will through their elected representatives. And this is how the citizens of the country indirectly participate in the decision-making process. Now, this parliament as the elected body performs three main functions. Now, the first and the most important function is that of law-making, wherein the parliament undertakes the legislative role and legislates the key policy and programs of the government. Now, the second important function is to select the national government that forms the executive, as they hold majority in the parliament. And the third and the last function is to control and guide the government of the day and to ensure that the policies of the government are in line with the constitutional provisions. In order to do so, the parliament involves various tools and methods such as use of parliamentary committees, discussion over question hour, zero hour, etc. So now this is how, along with legislative role, parliament ensures the accountability of the executive through the scrutiny of government's day-to-day functioning. Now let us look how in the recent times the Indian Parliament has been facing various issues with respect to its functioning. Now one of the most important factors for decline in effectiveness of Parliament is reduced number of sittings. Now if the Parliament will not actually meet or sit for discussion, how will the legislature be discussed and be scrutinized effectively? Now as you can see in front of you, and as you can see, there has been an absolute reduction in the number of scheduled days for which the Lok Sabha has sat for discussion, as well as there has been reduction in the number of hours per day that the Lok Sabha has sat in the parliament over the recent years. Further, even in the case of the 17th Lok Sabha that is ongoing, the Lok Sabha sat for 34 days while the Raj Sabha sat for merely 33 days. Now, this reduced number of sittings is massively affecting the functioning of the parliament. Now, the next important factor for declining effectiveness is increased disruption of the house. Now, it is the chaos in the house that is causing the Lok Sabha to not work effectively even for the limited number of days that it has been sitting. Now the third factor is that the reduced number of reference of bills to the parliament committees. Now as we had discussed earlier, the parliamentary committees scrutinize the legislatures and the bills that have been introduced in the parliament and give out a constructive criticism and feedback with respect to the same. Now in the 16th Lok Sabha, merely 27% of the bills were referred to parliamentary committee, while the case has even worsened in the 17th Lok Sabha, wherein only 11% of the bills were put in front of the parliament committee for scrutiny. And thus there has been a massive decline in the efficacy of the working of the parliaments and the standing committees. Now, next important challenge is with respect to dubious practice of making bills as money bill. Now, as we know, with respect to the money bill, Raj Sabha has limited power. So, government of the day, when does not have majority in the Raj Sabha, often uses this tactics to pass the bill in question. And hence, in the recent years, we are seeing maximum bills are being marked as money bill and are passed quickly in the Raj Sabha without any debate or discussion. And thus, this is one of the greatest reasons for decline in parliament scrutiny of the legislature. And this was also highlighted by the Supreme Court of India when it read down few sections of the Aadhaar Act that was put in front of the parliament as a money bill. Now moving on to the next challenge. Now this is with respect to increased criminalization of politics. Now over the years we are seeing more and more number of people with criminal backgrounds making in the Parliament of India. Now as you can see, there has been a continuous rise in the number of people with criminal cases in the Parliament. Now reports by Association of Democratic Reform suggest that there were as much as 43% of winners of 29 Lok Sabha that had criminal cases against them. How grave a concern is this for the parliamentary democracy that we boast of? And thus there is immediate need to fix the concern with respect to criminalization of politics that Indian democracy is facing. Now moving on to the last concern is with respect to the absence of deputy speaker in the parliament. Now it is the article 93 of the Indian constitution that suggests that the house of the people shall as soon as they may choose two members of the house, that is the speaker and the deputy speaker. Usually the deputy speaker is elected within a couple of months for the formation of the new Lok Sabha. However, in the recent years, there has been certain discrepancy with respect to the election of deputy speaker. Now, it took 16th Lok Sabha almost 70 days to elect the deputy speaker. However, with respect to 17th Lok Sabha, even up till the 51st day, the deputy speaker was not elected. Now, what happens in case deputy speaker is not elected and the speaker is not able to attend the parliament proceeding? Now, there comes a gap, that is, who will head the proceedings of the Lok Sabha? And it is because of these reasons that the parliament has seen decline in its functioning. Now, let us look into few measures to improve the efficiency of the Indian parliament. Now, the first important measure suggested here is to increase the number of minimum days for which both the houses of the parliament sit for legislative work. Here, we need to adopt the best practices as prevalent in countries such as UK, Canada and Australia, who have introduced similar measures. Second important measure is to insulate the functioning of parliament from externalities, such as COVID pandemic. Now, while the whole country was working from home and were working digitally, the parliament could not adopt to technological solutions and could not start remote working by the parliamentarians. And hence that affected the functioning of the 17th Lok Sabha. Now, moving on to the next measure, that is to improve and increase the scrutiny by the parliament committees, such that all the bills and the budgets are examined by committees and public feedback is taken on the same. Further, it is suggested that there is a need to create a system of research support for all the members of the parliament to help them scrutinize the legislature better. Further, it is also suggested that there is need to grant sufficient time for MPs to examine all the issues in front of them. And hence, these steps will help enhance the scrutiny that the parliament is supposed to undertake as a constitutional mandate. Now, next important measure is to clearly interpret the definition of money bill and to provide guidelines within which a bill have to stay so as to be granted this title. Now, this is very important so as to ensure that the functioning of Raj Sabha is not encroached upon and its power with respect to bills is not diminished. Now, the last suggestion is with respect to changing the provision of anti-defection law. Now, as was observed by Supreme Court in Kihoto Holohan case, that we must limit the disqualification of member only to crucial votings, such that the anti-defection law is not invoked over every voting that happens in the parliament. Now, this would ensure active participation without a fear of disqualification among the members of the parliament. And hence, these measures, if adopted, will play a key role in improving the functioning of the parliament. So now, in conclusion, here we can say that the parliament needs to ensure sufficient scrutiny over the proposal and actions of the government is undertaken. Now, as effective parliament scrutiny would not only ensure accountability of the executive, but would also help improve the actual quality of the laws that are passed in the country. So, with this, we come to the end of this discussion. Now, moving on to the next article. Now, this article appearing on the page number 16 of the Hindu newspaper talks about the recent attempt by Japan to extend the first ever official development assistance to Andaman and Nicobar Island. Now, this has been done with the purpose of boosting the island's power supply. Now, this sudden interest of Japan in Andaman and Nicobar Islands can be understood from the viewpoint of the Indo-Pacific region. Now, in the recent times, the Indo-Pacific has become the area of global contestation, and hence all the important global powers are trying to enhance their influence over this region. Now, in order to further understand the importance of Indo-Pacific region, kindly refer to the DNS dated 13 March 2021, wherein we discussed in detail about the quadrilateral summit that recently took place. Herein we are also discussed about the quadrilateral leaders and their vision of open and free Indo-Pacific of which both India and Japan, along with US and Australia, have been members. Now, India and Japan, as key players of the region and as strategic member of the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, have been working in the direction of strengthening the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Given its strategic location, it can play a key role in ensuring their vision with respect to Indo-Pacific. And hence, India and Japan have come together with respect to development of this set of islands. Now, in this article, as we move ahead, we shall discuss first the Andaman Nicobar location, the strategic significance of Andaman Nicobar, the initiatives that India has been taking in the recent years to tap onto this strategic significance, and at last, the challenges that India is sought to face with respect to its development of these islands. So now let's begin. Now, Andaman Nicobar Island, as located between the Bay of Bengal in west and Andaman Sea in the east, is a group of 572 islands that has been divided into a set of two groups of islands, the Andaman Islands and the Nicobar Islands. Now, it is the 10-degree channel that divides the Andaman Island and the Nicobar Island, which is reflected here. And it was in the prelims of 2014 that UPSC had framed a question around the same. The question read, which of the following pairs of islands is separated from each other by 10-degree channel? Now, the correct answer here was option A, Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Further, another important channel that one needs to make note of with respect to prelims is the Great Channel that divides the Nicobar Island from the Indonesian Peninsula. This is also known as the 6-degree channel. Further, another important point from the point of view of Andaman and Nicobar is with respect to Andaman and Nicobar Command. Now, this is the only tri-service geographical command of the Indian Armed Forces that is strategically located in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now, let us look into the geostrategic significance of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now, development of these islands will help strengthen India's hold over its Indian Ocean backyard. Now, it is the Indian Ocean backyard wherein we are witnessing growing Chinese ingress, and as a result of which, India is concerned with respect to its influence over the region of Indian Ocean alongside the greater region of Indo-Pacific, wherein India is seeing growing interest. And hence, strengthening its hold through development of Andaman and Nicobar Island will not only give India a security edge, it will help India become a security provider for the littoral states of the Indian Ocean region. Further, it will also help India to counter the growing Chinese threat in the region. Further, it will help India secure the global trade route that passes through the Strait of Malacca. Now, the Strait of Malacca is a choke point between Malaysia and Indonesian islands, and this accounts for at least 80% of global oil and trade flow. And hence, the proximity of Andaman and Nicobar Island to Malacca Strait makes India a key player with respect to regional security and safeguarding of sea lines of communication. Now, next important strategic significance is, of course, with respect to India's strategic interest in Indo-Pacific region, as has been reflected in its membership of the Quad Security Alliance. Now, the next important significance is in context of strengthening international relations. Now, tapping on geostrategic significance on Andaman and Nicobar Islands will play well for India's ACTIS policy and for strengthening its relationship with the ASEAN region. Further, the development of Andaman and Nicobar Island will also be important from the point of view of countering Chinese policies such as the String of Pearls policy and Maritime Silk Route that it has been undertaking in the region of Indian Ocean. And it is because of this that the Chinese military strategists have called the development of Andaman Island as the metal chain that could block Chinese access to European Union and Middle East. And hence you can understand the geostrategic significance that Andaman and Nicobar Islands hold for India. Now let us look into what initiative India has taken with respect to development of this island. Now, other than seeking foreign collaboration with respect to development of Andaman and Nicobar Island, as was done in case of Japan, India has been undertaking various domestic policy measures to further develop this island. Now, in this regard, India has been boosting connectivity with the Andaman-Nicobar chain of island. Herein, it has decided to develop a transshipment and logistic facility at the Great Nicobar Island. Further, it has been decided to develop Andaman Development Agency for expediting the holistic development of these sets of islands. Further, it has also decided to develop critical infrastructure in the region, and thus it has been undertaking the development of undersea optical fiber network to take internet to this archipelago. And at last, various policy measures by Niti Aayog has been furthering the vision of sustainable development of various islands of the Andaman and Nicobar sets of islands. And given the speed with which the policy measures and collaboration has been ongoing, Andaman and Nicobar Island will soon play a strategic edge for India in the Indian Ocean and the Indo-Pacific region at large. Now let us look into the few challenges that India might face with respect to leveraging the geostrategic potential of Andaman and Nicobar Island. The first important threat is with respect to environment. Now these islands have been declared as biodiversity hotspot. Now their development can cause massive impact on the flora and the fauna of this region. Further, the region lies on the high seismic level, and thus any development on this region becomes highly vulnerable. Now, third important challenge is with respect to projecting big brotherly image that India has been trying to counter for years. Now, India being a big country of the region has often been projected as big brother, wherein it tries to impose policies over other smaller region. And now India fears that development of Andaman and Nicobar region from the point of view of security might further make the smaller countries insecure and threatened. And at last, the fear of antagonizing China by strengthening the military and the economic development of Andaman and Nicobar Island that lies very close to the Chinese choke point, that is the Malacca Strait, as we had discussed earlier. And thus, while Andaman and Nicobar Island holds a lot of potential for India in terms of both strategic importance and economic importance, it also holds a lot of challenge for India. And thus, balancing both these is key for forwarding India's interests in the region. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Now, moving to the next article. Now, this article appearing on the page number 16 of the Hindu newspaper talks about the recently released Chief Information Commission Annual Report 2019 and 20. Now, in this report, the CIC highlights the high rejection rate of appeals that have been filed before various ministries of the government. Now, in this list, it is the Home Ministry that tops the chart with 1 out of 5 RTI requests being rejected in the year 2019. Now, since this topic talks about the RTI, it falls under the mandate of GS Paper 2, subsection governance. Now, in this article, let us look into the key things that this report talks about. And in this regard, let us take up this practice question. So, this question reads, consider the following statements regarding filing of RTI application in India. The first statement suggests that there has been a constant increase in the filing of RTI application since the RTI Act came into effect. Second statement suggests for the year 2019-20, maximum number of RTI were rejected on grounds of infringement of copyright as provided under Section 9 of the RTI Act. And the last statement suggests that Ministry of Finance and Prime Minister Office did not reject any application filed in 2019-20. Now let us try to get back to the report, understand its finding and the reason suggested behind these rejections. And then let's get back to this question. Now, RTI, as you all know, was introduced in 2005 as the Right to Information Act. Now, the act aimed to secure for the citizens right to access information that has been held by public authorities. Now, this act derives its power from two main articles of the Constitution, that is Article 19(1)(a) and Article 21 of the Indian Constitution, that guarantees rights to a citizen to know everything. Thus, the legislative intent behind this act was to foster a system of transparency and accountability in every public office and authority. And thus, this act provides for few key provisions, such as Section 4, that provides for suo motu disclosure of information, that puts obligation on public authorities to mandatory disclose information on various aspects with respect to the structure and functionings of these authorities. However, since all the information can never be put in public domain because it might affect India's security, foreign relations and integrity, and hence there have been certain restrictions that have been introduced under various provisions such as the Section 8, Section 9, Section 11 and Section 24. Now, Section 8 exempts disclosure of information that affects the sovereignty, integrity, security, strategic, scientific or economic interest of the state or its relation with foreign. Now, Section 8 exempts information with respect to India's integrity, sovereignty, security, economic or strategic interest. Further, even it restricts information if it affects India's relation with any other foreign state. Now, with respect to Section 9, it restricts information and suggests that the information can be denied if it involves infringement of copyright. Now, as per Section 11, information that with respect to Section 11, the third party information cannot be disclosed. And at last, Section 24 suggests that this RTI Act does not apply to intelligence or security organization as has been specified in Section 2 of the Act. And at last is Section 25 of the RTI Act that provides that both Central Information Commissioner and State Information Commissioner shall, after the end of each year, prepare an annual report with respect to implementation of the provisions of the Act during that year and present this report in front of the Parliament. And thus it is with respect to this provision that this annual report has been submitted. Now let us look into the key findings of the report. Now, the CIC annual report that covers more than 2000 public authorities across the central government as well as the union territories has presented findings of the report, as per which over the past 15 years, that is since 2005 when RTI came into being, there has been a varied increase with respect to the filing of RTI. While overall trend is that of increase, but this increase is not continuous as is evident in this bar diagram. Further, it is suggested that with respect to rejection and request, it was the Ministry of Home Affairs that topped the chart, and it has seen to have rejected 20% of total application that was filed in front of it. Further, with respect to other ministries, the data has been presented here. Now let us look with respect to what provisions have maximum rejection been undertaken. Now, as per the data shared, the maximum rejection was under Section 8(1) that talked about exemption from disclosure of information with respect to sovereignty, integrity, security, strategic, scientific and economic interest of the country. This accounted for as much as 46% rejection. Further, the second highest rejection was in the Section 24 that provides exemption to intelligence and security organization. In this case, the exemption rate was as much as 13%. Now let us go back to the previous question. Now let us go back to the practice question and see if we can answer the question now. Now the first statement of the question reads There has been a constant increase in the filing of RTI application since the RTI Act came into effect. Now, as we had just seen the bar diagram, this is not correct. Second statement reads, for the year 2019-20, maximum application of RTI were rejected on the grounds of infringement of copyright. That is provided under Section 9, which again is incorrect, for maximum rejection has been under Section 8-1. Now, the third statement talks about Ministry of Finance and PMO office did not reject any application filed in 2019-20. Now, for this, I will request you to go back to the table and check if Ministry of Finance and Ministry of Prime Minister's office has not rejected or have rejected any RTI application in the year 2019-2020. So, with this, we come to the end of this discussion. Now, this article appearing on the page number 1 of the Hindu newspaper talks about the death of two people while cleaning the septic tank. Now, this raises the concern with respect to the sanitation workers in India and with respect to the problem of manual scavenging that Government of India has been trying to get rid of for years. But sadly, the problem is still with us, as has reflected in this article. Now, since this topic is with respect to social justice, it falls under the mandate of GS Paper 2. Now, let us look into the status of sanitation worker in India. Now, since last 5 years, there has been a recorded 28% increase with respect to death while cleaning septic tanks. Now, this is all while the Government of India has been trying to reduce manual scavenging and cleaning of septic tanks. Further, as per National Commission of Safai Karmchari, a total of 54,000 people are still engaged in manual scavenging as per 2018 data. Now, it is suggested, although there has been a decline in the construction of dry latrines, but still the number of deaths related to manholes and sewer cleaning remains high. Further, the Employment of Manual Scavenging Act has also proposed various amendments, but still the issue of labour safety has not been addressed. And even the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan has not been successful in addressing this issue alongside the social stigma that has been attached to sanitation in India. Now, let us look into the interventions that has been undertaken in the recent years with respect to this problem. Now, the Government of India in 1993 enacted the Employment of Manual Scavenger Construction of Dry Latrine Provision Act. Now, this act, although was very good, but was lacking in certain matters, such as it only defined manual scavenger as a person who has been engaged in employment of carrying human excreta by hands. And this excluded the sanitation worker that actually entered the manhole from the ambit of this law, because of which the death that has been reported in today's newspaper occur. And thus, there was an amendment made to this act in 2013 by the Prohibition of Employment of Manual Scavenger and Rehabilitation Act 2013. Now, through this act, the scope of this act was widened and it acknowledged the urgency of rehabilitating manual scavengers and banned the sanitation workers from entering manhole. Now, let us look into the key features of this act. It prohibited the construction of insanitary toilets such as dry latrine. It prohibited engagement of manual scavenger and imposed fine of 50,000 or imprisonment for person who employs such a person. It prohibited a person from being engaged from hazardous activities such as cleaning sewer or septic tank. It made the offences cognizable and non-bailable under the Act, and it provided for a survey of manual scavenger in both urban and rural area within a time-bound manner. And since then, the implementation of this Act is undergoing. Further, Supreme Court in 2014 made it mandatory for government to identify all those died in sewage work and provide a 10 lakh compensation to the family. Now, further, the Government of India has adopted a too long prolonged strategy for eliminating insanitary latrine through demolition and conversion into sanitary toilets. This is specially being done through Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Further, it has provided for comprehensive rehabilitation package that put together livelihood and skill development to ensure that manual scavengers are able to opt for other livelihood beyond manual scavenging and septic tank cleaning. Further, there has been establishment of National Commission of Safai Karamchari to look into matters concerning Safai Karamchari and their welfare. In this regard, there has been incorporation of National Safai Karamchari Financial and Development Corporation that has issued various advisory to municipal and panchayat to ensure that all sanitation workers are provided with personal protection equipment to ensure their safety during the coronavirus pandemic. Now, here from prelims point of view, please keep in mind that the National Commission of Safai Karamchari is a non-statutory body and it falls under the mandate of Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. Further, with respect to National Safai Karamchari and Finance Development Corporation, again this falls under the mandate of Ministry of Social Justice. Further, even the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs had launched Safai Mitra Suraksha Challenge. Now, under this challenge, all states and UTs were made to pledge to make sure all sewer cleaning process is now mechanized and does not require human intervention. So, with this, we come to the end of this discussion. Thank you. With this, we come to the question of the day. There's an announcement for all of you. There will be no DNS on 28th and 29th March on account of Holi. We wish you a very happy Holi on behalf of Rouse IAS and the whole team of DNS. Thank you.